Baha Tustin, and here is our delightful professor, Professor McNeil.
Nice shirt there, Goldfarb. Well, right now, we're going to go through the major graphs that we've experienced in Econ 2. We're going to label them and then point out a few of the interrelationships. All right, this is my favorite. It is the... Oh, thanks. Production function. And on the horizontal axis, we have quantity of something. They're all quantity for the most part. There's quantity. But they're all different quantities. And, oh, this is not. Okay. So, this is the quantity of labor. This is real GDP. Now, what this says is that given what are fixed, assuming fixed technology, fixed capital, and fixed natural resources, this is the production function, which is the relationship between labor inputs, given the existing capital, stock, and technology, and so forth, labor inputs, how much output we get. So this says, if there are 10 million workers, we plug them in here, and this will give us $200 billion worth of output. If we have 15 million workers, oh, look, we get $350 billion worth of output. It assumes that these things are constant. So what happens if one of them changes? That is, if we get more technology, better capital, etc., then the production function will shift upward. And it gets steeper. That's an important point. Okay. Here are the labor markets. This is the demand for labor. This is the supply of labor. And this is the equilibrium of quantity of workers working. That is, when the labor markets are in equilibrium, there are that many workers working. And this is the real wage. So on the vertical axis here, we have real wage. Sorry, I have to put it in this in here. Now, if these two are related in that, if this number, the equilibrium quantity of workers working, is 15 million workers, then we would plug this into our production function and say, with 15 million workers working, we will get $350 billion worth of real GDP. Okay, over here, this one, we have our friend long-run aggregate supply, short-run aggregate supply, and aggregate demand. On the horizontal axis, we have real GDP, which is real quantity produced, and on the vertical axis, we have the price level. So, this economy is in equilibrium because the intersection of short-run aggregate supply and aggregate demand coincides with long-run aggregate supply. So, in this case, our potential, shown by long-run aggregate supply, is equal to the actual level of output shown by the intersection of short-run aggregate supply and aggregate demand. Now, this is connected to these other two as well, because what happens if we were to get more workers, for instance? What if we had 20 million workers? Well, we would plug 20 into our labor force here, and this would cause us to be able to produce, we'll say, $400 billion worth of output. And that would that means that our potential level of output is now, instead of 350, it is now 400. So this would be $400 billion worth of output. So this is economic growth when the long-run aggregate supply curve shifts to the right, and the short-run aggregate supply curve piggybacks with it, and it piggybacks it when it moves. So these are all connected. One last little bit is, if capital increases, for instance, or technology improves, that would cause this production function to shift upward, and so with this same, 15 million workers working, we can now get more output with the, even if the the labor supply does not increase. With 15 million workers working, we can now get more production because we've got better technology, more capital, more natural resources. And the other last little bit, but it's an important one, is since we're now on this new production function and right there, that same 15 millionth worker working, the slope of this function is steeper now. This means that the marginal product of labor has increased, and the marginal product of labor, I'm killing this for a second, the marginal product of labor determines labor demand. So when marginal product increases, labor demand increases, and the real wage will rise a bit because worker productivity has risen. All right, well, those three are related, obviously. What's this one? This one is money supply. This is money demand. Money demand is the demand to do what with money?
To hold money.
That's right, George. This is the quantity of money, in dollars, of course, and this is nominal interest. It's the cost of holding money. So when the money markets are in equilibrium, this is the quantity of money held. It's the amount that the Fed puts out there. And this is the interest rate in the money markets. Bonds. This is the demand for bonds. That's the supply of bonds. This is the quantity of bonds. And on the vertical axis is the price of bonds. So this price would be $950 or something like that. And that's the quantity of bonds traded this day or this week or this month in our market. Now, once this price is established, $950, you take the $50 yield on this. Remember, this $950 becomes $1,000 in 1 year. So it yields $50 on a base of $950 and times 100 to make it a percent. I believe this is 5.07% or something like that. And these bond this bond price has to be consistent with this interest rate. So these are related in that way. These are the foreign exchange markets. This is the quantity of dollars supplied, supply of dollars, and demand for dollars in the foreign exchange market. This is for when Americans want to buy foreign goods or foreign people want to buy U.S. goods. So the horizontal axis is the quantity of dollars in this market being traded each day. In the real world, the foreign exchange markets do between $1 and $2 trillion of turnover a day. The vertical axis is really the price of a dollar expressed as SOCs. Those are some other currency per dollar. So this, if it's 3, this says that the rate of exchange between dollars and SOCs is 3 to 1. 3 SOCs for $1. This is the quantity. This is investment demand, and this is the quantity of dollars demanded for investment. Quantity of dollars demanded for investment, and this is the interest rate. And this point, for instance, would say, if the interest rate is, what did we do up here? 5.07. If the interest rate is 5.07, this is the quantity of dollars that will be demanded for by businesses to make investments, to buy capital goods with. Well, obviously, this interest rate of 5.07 comes from the money markets here, interacting with the bond markets, of course, and as a result of the money supply, which is determined by Federal Reserve policy. This diagram is aggregate expenditures. So this we would label AE. This is a 45-degree line for reference. This vertical axis is AE. Aggregate expenditures means total spending. And on the horizontal axis is income. Now, income can be a proxy for the value of the goods produced as well. It can be the proxy for a real GDP because the value of the goods produced must equal the value of the income from the production of the goods. In equilibrium, this is real income. That's the equilibrium level of income, and that will be aggregate expenditures. And since they're equal, a point on the 45 degree line shows that they're equal, then this provides us with a macroeconomic equilibrium. And there's lots more to say, of course, like everything from zero here up to here is autonomous expenditure, and all of the rest is induced. There's a multiplier. The slope of the AE tells us is the basis for the formula for the multiplier and so forth. Anyway, there's lots more to talk about, but these are the basic eight that you guys should be familiar with. And so, I would like to say,
sayonara.